watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Jerry Turney and I'm your host and instructor. And today we're going to talk about roses. We've got some mystery plants right here for you. This shouldn't be too big a mystery. I picked these up just the other day at a nursery and they're a real nice winter flower, but they're our mystery plant. Last week we did have a mystery object, what was called a wood rose. I didn't bring it back in to show it to you, but that's what our last mystery object was. And I don't really have any samples of diseases or pests that I often bring in today, but I do have some unusual fruit we'll look at too. Not too unusual, but a little bit unusual. So we'll look at those. If you have a question about your garden, this is a live garden show. So call in at 1-800-339-1193. If you have a question about your garden, if you had a pest problem, if you had plants not do well, got poor yield, whatever their problem. I'm a plant pathologist. My undergraduate degree is in botany. My graduate degree is in plant pathology. I'm a certified arborist and agricultural pest control advisor. So I've spent my entire career working on plants and helping people grow plants in their garden, from vegetables to grass to turf. And today we're going to talk about roses. So, and roses is a big subject. We'll try and fit in to our 2 hours. We'll try and fit in everything we can about roses, but you could actually spend a good week talking about roses and not repeat yourself once. So now let's go to our upcoming events. We like to always start the show with upcoming events. If you're a student, you need to attend an upcoming event, or an outside event, I should say, and then write a short essay detailing what you learned at that event. So it could be a garden club, it could be a lecture at one of the botanical gardens. But let's take a look at what we have on our calendar for you to put down on your calendar and maybe get out and enjoy our wonderful weather and some beautiful gardens. So Hipster Botany, a crash course in plant ID. This will be at the LA County Arboretum on October 15th from 9 to 5. This is an all-day event, so give them a call at 626-821-4623 if you're interested in attending that. So our next event is the Weekend Walks at Descanso Gardens, October 15th, 11 to 12. So these are probably held every weekend. And you can, I imagine, it's an hour garden-led tour or walk. And give them a call at 818-949-4200. If you're interested in attending their garden walk or these weekend walks, I think they're free with admission. That's not an extra fee to go on the walk. And it's always nice to have a little tour through the garden, have somebody point out some features you might not notice or tell you a little information about the garden that you might not have noticed. In addition to that, we have the Garden Talk, Chilean Plants at the Huntington Garden on October 13th from 2:30 to 5. This is their monthly garden talk. And they'll be talking about plants native to Chile. So that would be a really interesting talk. Give them a call at 626-405-2100 for more information about this particular lecture. But there is a monthly garden lecture at the Huntington, and they usually are very interesting and full of a lot of really good information on gardening and some unusual plants that you might want to start growing in your garden. So our last event, I think, is this next one, is the Composting 2. This is Fullerton Arboretum on October 15th from 10 to 11:30. This will be a demonstration and class on how to compost in your garden, what you can put in and what you shouldn't put in, which is always an interesting discussion because people can disagree on this to some extent. So give them a call at 657-278-3407 for more information about that. And let's take a look at a little bit of fruit I brought in. And this, let's just go to the overhead real quick. And I'm just going to shove these to the side and you guys can try and remember that that's our mystery plant, and we can just put this right here. And I'm going to put this right here. Okay, here's this piece of fruit. And then here is these two pieces of fruit. And these are both guavas. This is growing just down the street from me in a neighbor's front yard. And I believe, you know, of course, it's not labeled, so you've got to try and figure out what it is. You know it's a guava. This looks like the yellow-fruited cherry guava, also sometimes called the lemon guava, which is Psidium literale, variety literale. Littoral. Maybe I'm mispronouncing that. So it's basically the same species as the strawberry guava, but it turns yellow instead of red. So that is, and if you cut this in half, it, you know, it's a typical guava. Now this next one here is called the Mexican guava. I'd never seen it before this week. And let me just see if I can figure out which one it is, because this is a new species, a new type of fruit to me. And let's see here. Let's take a quick look and see if I can get this. There's many different kinds of guavas. There's tropical pink, Mexican cream, which is a Psidium. So it's at least in the same genus. You also hear sometimes about a pineapple guava. It's not really in the Psidium genus. It's in a different genus. So this particular one here in my hand is an upright tree originating from Mexico, small to medium fruit, roundish fruits. Skin light yellow, slightly blushed with red, fresh, creamy white, very sweet, fine textured, and excellent for dessert. Seed cavity small with relative soft seeds. That's the Mexican cream, and I'm not sure that that is the right fruit. But anyway, when I was I saw these just recently, I just saw this week actually, and I was told this is called the Mexican guava. So there's a lot of different kinds of guavas. They're popular, especially in the Asian community. It's an unusual fruit. So if you're tired of growing kind of the same fruit over and over again, you grow apples and you grow peaches and nectarines, you ought to grow something a little different. Well, think about that, and think about this next one I'm going to show you real quick. This is called the white sapote. Now, it's a little small and it's hard as a rock, so it got picked early and it's not soft. But this is white sapote, which is a really excellent fruit and a nice tree. So there's a lot of different kinds of fruit trees. You don't have to keep growing this same thing over and over again. You know, think about a white sapote or a guava, that would be something different to grow in your garden, because sometimes, you know, you see the same thing in gardens over and over and over again. It's nice to see something unique, a little different. And in fact, this yellow guava and this white sapote are out of the same garden. Now, the person who lived in that house planted these things was into tropical fruits. And there's a lot of really good, interesting tropical fruits. And if you're really into this, if you're interested in maybe some unusual fruits, you want to go to the California Rare Fruit Growers Society website. And you can just type in California Rare Fruit Growers into any search engine, and you'll find their website. And they list a lot of different types of fruit trees. And they also list avocado, but, you know, cherimoya, rambutan, lychee, a lot of unusual fruit trees. And now there's a lot of nurseries carrying these. Mostly, I see a couple of nurseries that I know are bringing these things in fairly frequently from Florida. So the trees are available in the trade. You can find them. The nurseries aren't hard to find. They're in the San Gabriel Valley for the most part, but they're in other parts of the county too. And so they're out there. We don't seem to get cold anymore in the winter. In the past, you might have been afraid that some of these fruit trees, like if you wanted to grow lychee or rambutan, that those would freeze. Well, we're not getting cold enough to freeze anymore in the winter. So we can switch over and start growing more tender materials. And I might mention that a lot of people don't understand that term tender versus hardy. In a horticultural sense or definition, tender means sensitive to cold. So if something's tender, it freezes and is damaged. Like avocados are tender. If you get down into the 20s, you'll freeze the leaves. Citrus is not nearly as sensitive as avocado, but bananas are very tender. Coconut palms, you couldn't grow those in Southern California because one good cold winter and it'd kill it. So, you know, most of the palm trees are tender. So, and when you say something's hardy, it means it can take cold, it can take freezing temperatures and not be killed. When we talked about citrus last weekend, the kumquats, Fortinella, are incredibly hardy. You can get them down to 18 degrees without any frost or freezing damage, whereas an orange tree or a lemon or a lime would be damaged as soon as you get to 28, or certainly by 25 degrees, you'd have freezing damage to your tree. So that's what we mean when we say something is tender or something is hardy. Hardy doesn't mean that it grows vigorously and is a great plant or is tough. It means that it can withstand cold temperatures. Let's talk about roses. There's nothing more popular than roses. Roses dominate the nursery trade to a large extent. The value in roses in terms of plants sold exceeds the value of all other plants propagated, which is hard to believe, but it's true. Roses are the king of the nursery trade, and they're incredibly popular. There's a handful of reasons why they're so popular. One is their modern roses particularly are prolific. You get lots and lots of flowers. They're fairly easy to grow, especially if you pick the disease-resistant ones and not grow things that have high susceptibility to powdery mildew or rust or black spot, so you don't have to spray them all the time. And they're scented. Many of the roses are scented, so that's nice. There's a lot, and the variety is unbelievable. There's so many different kinds of roses out there. You can get long-stemmed teas that are great for cutting and bringing inside for cut flowers inside your house. You can get floribundas that are excellent in the landscape with lots and lots of flowers and really put on a show in the landscape. Not so good for bringing indoors, but excellent in the landscape. Now we have carpet roses, which are being grown as ground covers. So there's just a whole bunch of different kinds of roses, you know, from teas to the miniatures, little tiny plants about this big with little tiny roses. Those are really nice in small pots in a patio, a nice accent plant, or in the ground. You can grow them in the ground, of course, but often grown in pots and used as an accent plant. So let's just talk about roses, and we'll start with their history. Roses were grown in all the early civilizations of temperate latitudes from at least 5,000 years ago. So they are ancient plants. They are known to have been grown in ancient Babylon. And if you study gardens, you've heard about the hanging gardens of Babylon. There's nothing left. It's all people just talk about it. So really famous gardens in Babylon. Paintings of roses have been discovered in Egyptian pyramid tombs from the 14th century BC. Records exist of them being grown in Chinese gardens and Greek gardens from at least 500 BC. So certainly roses are an ancient line of plants. Most of the plants grown in these early gardens are likely to have been species collected from the wild. However, there were large numbers of selected varieties being grown from early times. For instance, numerous selections of cultivars of the China rose were in cultivation in China in the first millennium AD. You know, a lot of things, Western society thinks we did, the Chinese did 1,000 years before us. So the Chinese were hybridizing plants and growing plants, actually, in many cases, way before Western European or European horticulturists and botanists were doing it. The significant breeding of modern times started slowly in Europe from about the 17th century. This was encouraged by the introduction of new species, especially the introduction of the China rose into Europe in the 19th century. In fact, that was a seminal point in rose history, was the introduction of the China rose. An enormous range of roses has bred since then. A major contributor to the early 19th century was Empress Josephine of France, who patronized the development of rose breeding at her gardens. And as long ago as 1840, a collection numbering over 1,000 different cultivars, varieties, and species was possible when a rosarium was planted for Abbey Park Cemetery, an early Victorian garden, cemetery, and arboretum in England. So that's a long time ago. 1840, you could have 1,000 different roses. Now, for most of us, we really only want a few roses in our garden. There's an old way of growing roses where you have a rose bed, and you have this big bed, and it's all roses. And that's fine if you're a rose enthusiast and that's how you want to grow them. I find that to be an old way of growing roses. I think roses should be integrated into the landscape. So you have roses and like plants that need the same environmental conditions, or particularly the watering regime. So you can grow other things that are that require the same treatment or growth conditions in with your roses. So you're not going to grow roses next to cactus because they need completely different watering. And we'll talk about how to water them, how to fertilize them, how to prune them too in a moment. Roses are placed into one of three main groups: wild, which would be species roses, old garden, and modern garden roses. And we're going to talk about all three groups today. The latter two groups are usually subdivided further according to hybrid lineage, although due to the complex ancestry of most rose hybrids, some of these distinctions can be imperfect or imprecise. Growth habit and floral form are also used as a means of classification. So let's talk about the wild roses and bring up our first picture. The wild roses, also known as species roses, includes the natural species and some of their immediate hybrid descendants. The wild roses commonly grown in gardens include Rosa moschata, which you see here in front of you. It's also called the musk rose. In addition, there's Rosa banksii, Lady Banks rose, Rosa pinnifolia, the Scots or Burnet rose, Rosa rubiginosa, the sweetbriar or eglantine, Rosa foidea in varieties Austin Cooper, Persian Double, and Harrison's Yellow. For most of these, the plants found in cultivation are also selected clones that are propagated vegetatively. Wild roses are low-maintenance shrubs in comparison to other garden roses, usually tolerating poor soil and some shade. They generally have only one flush of blooms per year, although some species have large hips in the autumn or have colorful autumn foliage. Rosa moschata, the musk rose you see here in this photo, is a species of rose long in cultivation. Its wild origins are uncertain, but is suspected to lie in the western Himalayas. Let's take a look at our next rose, Rosa banksii, a common name Lady Banks rose, tombstone rose, or just Banks rose, is a species of rose native to central and western China in the provinces of Gansu and quite a few others. At altitudes of 500 to 2200 meters, that's 1640 feet to 7000 feet. That's pretty high up. Our next one is Rosa pimpinifolia, and here you see a picture of that rose. Is a species of rose native to western, central, and southern Europe, north to Iceland and Norway, and northwest of Africa, so a pretty big distribution. It is generally restricted to sand dunes and limestone pavements and typically has a coastal distribution when not on limestone. Our next one is, take a look here, and this is Rosa rubiginosa, and let me see if I can just talk about that a minute here. Well, we'll go back to this rose in a moment. The next one I want to talk about is Rosa foidea, and that's our next picture, also called Harrison's Yellow. So this is Rosa foidea, known by several common names, including Austin Briar, Persian Yellow, and Austin Copper Rose, native to the foothills of the Caucasus Mountains in Georgia. It has yellow flowers with a scent which some find objectionable. Since there were no yellow roses native to Europe, its introduction from Persia was an important addition to the cultivation of roses. Rosa foidea is now an important contributor to the stock of cultivated roses. Harrison's rose, or the also known as the Oregon Trail rose, and let's see, trying to see which picture will show you Harrison's Yellow. And the Yellow Rose of Texas is a hybrid rose cultivar which originated as a chance hybrid seedling of Rosa foidea. The cultivar first bloomed at the suburban villa of George Harrison, attorney, between 8th and 9th Avenues on 32nd Street in New York City. The site of Harrison's villa is now just south of the present General Post Office. So this rose was marketed in 1830. Harrison's Yellow is naturalized at abandoned house sites throughout the West and is found as a feral rose along the Oregon Trail. So if we go to our next one is Rosa moisei, and here you see that one, is a species of rose native to Western China, growing to 13 feet tall by about 10 feet wide. It is a vigorous deciduous shrub with plentiful mat green leaves and flat red or pink flowers with yellow central stamens in summer. These are followed in autumn by prominent bottle-shaped rose hips. So those are some of the species roses. Let's talk a little bit about the old garden roses, and we'll take a look at our next one. This is maiden blush. An old garden rose is defined as any rose belonging to a class which existed before the introduction of the first modern rose, La France, in 1867. La France was the first hybrid tea. Alternative terms for this group include heritage or historic roses. In general, old garden roses of European or Mediterranean origin are once-blooming woody shrubs with notably fragrant, double-flowered blooms, primarily in shades of white, pink, and crimson red. So the one you see here is Rosa alba, also known as maiden blush, this particular one you're looking at. The shrub's foliage tends to be highly disease-resistant, and they generally bloom only from canes, which formed in previous years. Most old garden roses are classified into one of the following groups. So, well, this is alba, literally white roses, derived from Rosa arvensis and the closely allied Rosa ex alba. The latter species is a hybrid of Rosa gallica and Rosa canina. This group contains some of the oldest garden roses. The shrubs flower once yearly in the spring or early summer with scented blooms of white or pale pink. They frequently have gray-green foliage and a vigorous or climbing habit of growth. Examples are Alba simplina and the White Rose of York. Let's take a look at our next rose. It's the Wild Rose or of Gallica. And this is a Gallica rose. The Gallica or Rose of Provence group is very old class developed from Rosa gallica, which is a native of Central and Southern Europe and Western Asia. The apothecary's rose, Rosa gallica officinalis, was grown in the Middle Ages in monastic herbaria for its alleged medicinal properties and became famous in English history as the Red Rose of Lancaster. Gallicas flower once in the summer over low shrubs, rarely over 4 feet tall. Unlike most other once-blooming old garden roses, the Gallica class includes shades of red, maroon, and deep purplish crimson. Examples are Cardinal de Richelieu, Charles de Mills, Rosa Mundi. Cultivars of the species Rosa Gallica and hybrids close in appearance are considered as a cultivar group, the Gallica group of roses. Their exact ancestry is usually unknown, and other species may be involved. So the Gallica rose groups, Gallica group of roses share the vegetative characteristics of the species, forming low suckering shrubs. The flowers can be single, but most commonly are double or semi-double. The colors range from white, which is actually rare, to pink and deep purple. All Gallica group roses are once flowering. They are easily cultivated. So Rosa gallica, which you're seeing here again, is native to Southern and Central Europe, eastwards to Turkey and the Caucasus. Plants with semi-double pink flowers have been treated as either a variety under the name Rosa gallica variety officinalis or as a cultivar, Rosa gallica officinalis. It is also called the apothecary's rose, the crimson damask rose, or the red rose of Lancaster. It is the country flower of Lancashire. A cultivar Rosa gallica variety officinalis versicolor with striped pink blooms is also known as Rosa Mundi. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is Rosa gallica officinalis versicolor. This is the striped rose I just mentioned. If we take a look at this next one, this is Rosa gallica Charles de Mille, which arose before 1790. And I just want to mention, a lot of these old roses have this form, where you have a row of petals on the outside that are kind of flat petals, and then you have these curved petals inside. So that's a very common look to old garden roses. This species is easily cultivated on well-drained soil in full sun to semi-shade. It can survive temperatures down to minus 25 degrees centigrade. That's cold. It is one of the earliest cultivated species of roses, cultivated by the Greek and Romans and commonly used in medieval gardens. In the 19th century, it was the most important species of rose to be cultivated, and the most modern European rose cultivars have at least a small contribution from Rosa gallica in their ancestry. Our next rose is Rosa the Damask roses, named for Damascus, Damask roses, Rosa ex Damascena, originated in ancient times with a natural cross, Rosa moscata crossing with Rosa gallica, crossing again with Rosa fed, with another rose. Robert Debris is given credit for bringing Damask roses from the Middle East to Europe sometime between 1254 and 1276, although there is evidence from ancient Roman frescoes that at least one Damask rose existed in Europe for hundreds of years before this. Summer Damasks bloom once in summer, autumn. Once in summer, autumn or four seasons Damask bloom again later, but less exuberantly. And these were the first repeat flowering old European roses. Damask roses tend to have a rangy to sprawling growth habits and strongly scented blooms. Examples are Isfahan and Madame Hardy. So let's take a look at our next rose, which is Autumn Damask. And you can see that typical old rose form that you're going to see on a lot of these old roses. And then our next one is Rosa Isfahan. Take a look at that next picture. And again, this is an old rose, Rosa Isfahan. And I see, Okay, let's move on and just talk a little bit more about Damasks. So more commonly, these are called more commonly known as Damask rose, or sometimes Rose of Castile is a rose hybrid derived from Gallica and Moscata. DNA analysis has shown that there's also genes from Rosa, I'll try and pronounce this, Fedchenkoana. So that's the DNA evidence there that it's actually a three species hybrid. The flowers are renowned for their fine fragrance and are commonly harvested for rose oil, used in perfume and to make rose water and rose concrete. The flower petals are also edible. They may be used to flavor food, as a garnish, or as an herbal tea, and preserved in sugar. The Damask rose is deciduous, growing to about 7 feet tall, the stems densely armed with stout, curved prickles and stiff bristles. The leaves are pinnate with five, rarely seven, leaflets. The roses are light to moderate pink to light red. The relatively small flowers grow in groups. The bush has an informal shape. It is considered an important type of old rose and also important for its prominent place in the pedigree of many other types. So we saw Isfahan. And let me see, are we still looking at Isfahan? Yes, we are. Isfahan, also known as the pom-pom de princes, is a clear pink, half-open kind of Damask rose, an early type introduced from the Middle East in European breeding. So our next one we want to look at is Rosa Gallica Tuscany Superb. And there you see that one. This is Rosa Centifolia, I think. Centifolia. Okay. So we're moving on to our next group, the Centifolia. Centifolia roses are also known as cabbage roses or province roses. They are derived from Rosa ex Centifolia, raised in the 17th century in the Netherlands. They're named for their 100 petals. They are often called cabbage roses due to the globular shape of the flowers. And you can see here that this is, you know, quite round, and boy, that's a lot of petals in there. So I don't know if there's really 100. This is a result of Damask roses crossed with albas. The centifolias are all once flowering. As a class, they are notable for their inclination to produce mutations of various sizes and forms, including moss roses and some of the first miniature roses. Examples, centifolia, which we see right here. And let's take a look at the next picture, which is a close-up of centifolia. So there you go, Rosa centifolia. So what else do we know about this? It's developed by the Dutch, bred from Gallica, Moscata, and Canina, and Rosa damascena. Its exact hereditary history is not well documented. Individual plants are shrubby in appearance, growing to 1.5 to 2 meters in height. That's about 6 feet tall, with long drooping canes and grayish-green pinnate leaves, 5 to 7 leaflets. The flowers are round and globular with numerous thin overlapping petals that are highly scented. They're usually pink, less often white to dark purple. So Rosa centifolia is particular to the French city of Grasse, known as the perfume capital of the world, is widely cultivated for its singular fragrance. Clear and sweet, with light notes of honey, the flowers are commercially harvested for the production of rose oil, which is commonly used in perfume. Let's move on to our moss roses. The moss roses are based on a mutation of Rosa centifolia. Let's take a look at our next picture. And this is called a common moss rose. The moss roses are based on a mutation from a Rosa centifolia, some with damask roses as another parent. They bear mossy, resin-bearing glands on the sepals that often gives off a pleasant, woodsy, or balsam scent when rubbed. Moss roses are cherished for this unique trait, but as a group, they have not contributed further to development of new rose classifications. Moss roses with centifolia background are once flowering. Some moss roses exhibit repeat blooming, indicative of autumn damask parentage. Examples: common moss, Mousseline, also known as Alfred del Damas, the autumn damask rose. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is a Portland rose. This is a Portland rose. The Portland roses were long thought to be the first group of crosses between China roses and European roses, and to show the influence of Rosa chinensis. Recent DNA analysis, however, has demonstrated that the original Portland rose has no Chinese ancestry, but has an autumn damask Gallica lineage. This group of roses was named after the Duchess of Portland, who received from Italy about 1775 a rose then known as Rosa Pastana, or Scarlet Four Seasons rose, now known simply as the Portland rose. The whole class of Portland roses was developed from that one rose. The first repeat flowering class of rose with fancy European style blossoms, the plants tend to be fairly short and shrubby, with a suckering habit, with proportionally short flower stalks. The main flowering is in the summer, but intermittent flowers continue into the autumn. Examples are James Vetch, Rosa de Resch, and Comte de Chambord. And let's see what I have for you in pictures. Take a look at the next picture, which is James Vetch. And that's a pretty unique looking rose. Okay, let's talk about the China roses. Come on back to me. We'll get away from these pictures for a minute. I'm still here. So the China roses, based on Rosa chinensis, have been cultivated in East Asia for centuries. They have been cultivated in Western Europe since the late 18th century. They contribute much to the parentage of today's hybrid roses, and they brought a chance to form to They brought a change to the form of the flowers then cultivated in Europe. Compared with the older roses, rose classes known in Europe, the Chinese roses had less fragrant, smaller blooms, carried on twiggy, more cold-sensitive shrubs. However, they could bloom repeatedly throughout the summer and into late autumn, unlike their European counterparts. The flowers of China roses were also notable for their tendency to suntan or darken over time, unlike other blooms, which tended to fade after opening. This made them highly desirable for hybridization purposes in the early 19th century. According to Graham Stuart Thomas, China roses are the class upon which modern roses are built. Today's exhibition rose owes its form to the China genes, and the China roses also brought slender buds, which unfurl when opening. Tradition holds that 4 stud China roses, Slattner's Crimson China, Parsons Pink China, and the Tea Rose Hume's Blush Tea-Scented China, and Park's Yellow Tea-Scented China, were brought to Europe in the late 18th and early 19th centuries. In fact, there were rather more. At least 5 Chinas, not counting the teas, have been imported. This brought about the creation of the first classes of repeat flowering old garden roses, and later the modern garden roses. Examples are Old Blush China, Mutabilis, which is the butterfly rose, and Chamarcy superior. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is a Rosa mutabilis, the butterfly rose. And this is a fun rose. Let's take a look at this. We'll see the bush and the flowers up close. So here you go. This is a Rosa mutabilis. And what you see there are different colored flowers on the same plant. This most interesting rose was once sold as Tipo Ideal, and it is ideally suited to illustrate the typical China trait of darkening with age instead of fading. Nowhere is that trait more visible than in the flowers of mutabilis, whose single petals open sulfur yellow, changing through orange to a rich pink and finally crimson. Bring up the next picture and you'll see what this even better. They open yellow and then they turn this color. So they darken over time, which the European roses used to fade and their color diminished over time. So the single petals open sulfur yellow, changing through orange to pink to finally crimson. Bright, silky flowers of all these colors will often be on display at the same time, looking as if a group of multicolored butterflies had settled on the bush. This aspect earned mutabilis its common name, the butterfly rose. A healthy, well-branched shrub, mutabilis will easily grow to 6 feet, making a fine specimen plant whose showy flowers are accented by the bronze color of the new growth. This is a very popular rose due to its distinct coloration. Now, I have a video I'd like to go to now on old garden roses. So you can, you know, see these in the garden and see what they look like. So let's go to our first video, and when you come back, we'll talk more about roses. And if you want, give us a call, and we'll talk about the roses in your garden. Let's go to this video.
Hi, I'm Pam Collins, Director of Gardens in the Department of Plant and Soil Sciences at Mississippi State University. We are at the Veterans Memorial Rose Garden, where I'd like to show you a variety of old garden roses. The first rose I want to show you today is a damask rose called Kazanlik. It's a large, wild-growing shrub, and it blooms only in the spring. This rose has a soft pink bloom, slightly double in form, and the foliage is rough and sage green. The second cultivar I'd like to show you comes from Germany in the 1930s. Its name is Dr. Eichener, and it is a hybrid rugosa rose. The blooms on Dr. Eichener are very large, and they're fragrant, and they repeat bloom throughout the season. One of the nice aspects of Dr. Eichener is that the blooms range from a deep peach pink to a pale soft pink as they age. This shrub also is large and coarsely growing, and the thorns are really vicious. It tolerates poor soils as well. The foliage that you see on Dr. Eichener is very typical of hybrid rugosas. The surface of the leaf is very rough and rugged and has a lot of veins prominent on the surface. An example of roses that are derived from warmer climates, such as are found throughout the southern part of Europe, the Middle East, or the Far East, is Pax. Pax is a hybrid musk rose that was developed in England in 1918, and that's an appropriate name for peace at the end of World War I. The shrub is large and has long arching stems and lax growth habit that makes it nice to prop up against a fence. The blooms are a semi-double white, and they bloom continuously throughout the year. Again, this plant will tolerate poor soils. This is an example of a China rose. Its name is Rosa chinensis mutabilis, or butterfly rose. It's large, it's very twiggy, and it has very healthy foliage, and it makes a good landscape shrub. The flowers are single, and they range in color from dark pink to pale yellow. Another example of a China rose is Cramoisie superior, which was developed in France in 1832. It's a smaller shrub and makes it more useful in smaller garden spaces. The flowers are dark red, they're semi-double, and they are produced in large clusters. Again, the bloom is continuous throughout the garden season. Another rose of very ancient garden origins is Rosa Banksia lutea, or Lady Banks rose. It was imported in the early 1820s. The foliage is elegant, it's small, it has very healthy black spot resistant leaves that are semi-evergreen in Mississippi. It is a large rose and it needs to grow on a sturdy trellis. It's the first rose to bloom in the garden in spring, and it makes a great landscape plant. Another large climbing China rose is Cecile Bruner, also known as the sweetheart rose. It is a large and robust climber. It blooms in the spring only with many soft pink blooms and lovely buds. The foliage is healthy and it's abundant. The final cultivar I want to show you today is a tea rose called Duchess de Brabant. The growth habit is spreading and graceful, and there's abundant foliage. And this plant is very suitable for smaller garden spaces. The blooms are highly double, they're rose pink, they're very shapely, and they're cupped in their form. This plant will bloom throughout the season, and it needs a sunny, warm place to thrive. Spring has arrived, and we've seen plenty of color this afternoon. As you consider roses to include in your own garden, consider some of these cultivars to use as landscape shrubs. I'm Pam Collins for
Welcome back. Before we move on and talk about more of the different kinds of roses, I just wanted to go here to the Sunset Western Garden Book. And they have a good section in Sunset Western Garden Book talking about all the different kinds of roses. So here's the section on roses. It talks about climate. It talks about, you know, buying plants. It talks about location and planting, routine care, water, nutrients, pest and disease control. So there's a lot of discussion. Plus, they're going to discuss all these different varieties, types of roses, modern large flowered roses, hybrid teas, modern climbing roses, miniature roses, modern landscape roses. And it goes on, and they show you lots of pictures of really nice roses. But what do the roses really need? Let's just look at this short discussion of that. So you want full sun, some light afternoon shade in hottest regions. So I know people who've told me that they have to grow their roses under shade cloth or in a shady location out in Palm Springs and places like that. Well, you know, maybe roses aren't the best thing to grow in Palm Springs because, you know, you're going to have to grow them in the shade. But everyone loves their roses, so more power to them if they can get them to do well. But when it gets really hot, it's going to burn them. I had a white flowering rose in Riverside, and we had temperatures of 110 to 115 nearly for 2 weeks, and it burned every leaf off that plant. It was in the full sun on the southeast corner of my house, and it, you know, when it's over 110 degrees, it just fried it. So yes, roses are full sun, but in a hot region, you need afternoon shade, or you need shade all day. An open area with good air circulation helps discourage foliage diseases. That's marginally true. Don't plant with roots of trees or other shrubs will compete. So generally speaking, you want your roses out in the open, full sun. You don't want to have a lot of things planted around them. Give them their space. So, and that's true of any shrub. Be sure the soil is reasonably well drained. And that's, you know, some of this stuff you could say about any plant. Plants do like good drainage. That's the rule. Some plants actually grow in swamps, and that's the exception. So most plants want good drainage. They don't want to sit around in saturated, soggy soil all the time. Regular moisture is good, is essential for good growth and bloom. Mulch soil beneath plants to help conserve moisture, and you can reduce your water use by about 30%. By having about a 3 to 4 inch layer of compost underneath your roses. So you reduce as much as possible the evaporation of water from the soil. You want to only lose water as the roots take it up and it goes through the plant. So generally speaking, roses are moderate water users, not because you may say, well, moderate, how could that be? Why aren't they high water users? Well, because high water users are things like fuchsias. Lawns are the biggest water user there is, period. and then ferns, those kind of things, especially if you're in a hot inland valley, you're going to have to water those a couple times a week, and or your lawn three times a week. So that's a high water user. Roses are going to be kind of moderate. You're going to be able to give them maybe an inch a week, once a week in the summer. And if you get really hot, you may have to go to an inch and a half a week, which is about what you would give a lawn. But of course, if you only have a few shrubs, you can just water the base of the plant. You don't have to water 500 square feet or 1,000 square feet. The other reason lawns use so much water is they usually occupy quite a bit of square footage, and you have to water the whole area uniformly. When you're watering shrubs, you can water just each individual shrub. You can put a little emitter at each shrub. You can have a basin around it where you just fill it up. You don't have to water the entire square footage where the plant's growing, just the base of the plant. So you give it a good deep soak. Typically, I would water roses about twice a week in the spring and the fall, and once a week in the summer if you're in a hot inland valley. If you're down at the coast, if you're right along the coast where you stay cool, you might get away with only watering maybe every 3 weeks in the spring and the fall, every 2 weeks in the summer, and then if you get hot in August and September, you may even go up to once a week. Now, that's going to be influenced by your soil conditions too. If you've got a sandy soil, certainly you're going to go to once a week. If you've got a heavier clay and you're in an inland valley, then you might go every 10 days. I see we have a phone call. Let's go to our first caller. Who we have? Andy calling from Silver Lake. You're on the air.
Hi. Thank you for taking my call. Really appreciate your show very much. And I'm hoping you can help me with an insect problem I'm having.
Okay.
I have a vacant lot near my house, and it's being overrun with an orange insect about a half inch long at the most. I've seen some as short as a 16th of an inch, bright orange with a little black band across the back.
Okay,
they're crawling. So they don't seem to
let
be
me ask you a few questions.
Sure.
Are they're on a specific plant material? Where do you see the bugs?
They're crawling all over the ground and sidewalk. And I don't know where they're coming from. So far, I haven't seen any on any plant growth. There's very little plant growth around. But
they're orange?
Bright orange.
And they're not, and they're crawling on the ground.
Yeah.
Nothing pops to mind about what that might be. But I'll tell you, I can't identify it for you, but when it comes to insects, to a large extent, you need it in your hand to really know what you're looking at. Even photographs, good photographs, are often inadequate. Unless it's something well known, like the green fig beetle, which flies around right now with that shiny turquoise underneath. So what you can do is collect some of these insects in some type of crush-proof container, like a rinsed-out prescription bottle or any, little vial.
Right.
Put a handful of them in there, a few of them, and put them in the freezer for 15 minutes to
right.
kill them. And then you need to send that to the Los Angeles County Department of Agriculture Insect Identification. Now, I work for the LA County Ag Commissioner. I'm the plant pathologist. And so I do all the diseases. I identify weeds, I identify nematodes, but we have an entomologist too, Dr. Arkalian, who does all the insects. It's a free service, it doesn't cost you anything. You can bring it in or you can mail it in.
All right, I recommend it.
I know a lot of people call up and they see an insect and they go online and they think they've identified it, and they're 99% of the time they're wrong. Because it really requires a microscope and a little experience to correctly identify insects, unless it's something that's common and well known, like aphids on rose bushes. Who doesn't know those?
I'll be happy to send you anything that you need.
So, I should know my address offhand, but I don't.
It's in the phone book?
If you Google Los Angeles County Department of Agriculture, you should be able to find our mailing address on Garfield. Our where we are is on Garfield in Southgate. And I think it's, I'm trying to remember my address. I have it written down at my workstation so I can always tell people when I'm at work. But here I am forgetting my own address where I work. I never mail anything to myself. I think.
What is the phone number at work? Maybe
you could call me at 562-622-0433. That's my lab number. We're not in tomorrow because it's Columbus Day.
Right.
But we'll be back in Tuesday morning, and Dr. Arkalian will be back in Tuesday morning as well. He's been in Florida the last 2 weeks collecting bugs.
Very good.
So anyway, collect a few of them, put them in a crush-proof container, freeze them, give me a call Tuesday morning. Again, that number is 562-622-0433, and I'll give you our mailing address. I'm sorry I don't have it right now. I'll try and also get it up on the screen before the show's over today.
All right.
And if I have some of my business cards, it'll be on my business card.
All right. Thanks a lot. And look forward to talking.
You know, there are some bugs that are called red bugs that are both black and red. But maybe, you know, your description really doesn't fit that. And often I see them on the ground, a lot of them, and they're seed feeders. And so they're usually coming off of a tree. Like the tree I see them on the most are the coleopterias. But they feed on the seed, so they're not that big a pest, although they can be all over the place. It's not unusual to see insect populations explode and then disappear.
Well, that's why they've been there about a week. I kept thinking they'd be gone.
They may be gone in a week or two, too.
They've increased and are getting closer to the house day by day.
Well, pick up a few, send them to us, we'll tell you what they are. The first step in pest control is the correct identification of the pest.
Right.
So once we know what it is, then we can give you some tips on, what's it feeding on? How's it reproducing? And how can you control it? If you know its biology and the life cycle, then you pick the point in the life cycle that's most opportune or the weakest where you can get good control. Like I said, you know, in another week or two, they may be gone completely. But send us your bugs, and we'll tell you what they are.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, thanks for the call.
We'll talk to you Monday.
We'll try and get that mailing address up after our station identification at 1 o'clock. But just to continue with what roses need, of course, if I'm planting a new rose, whether I get a bare root rose in the winter or I get a potted rose in a 5-gallon pot, I want to dig a hole no deeper than the root ball. I don't want that root ball to drop down below grade. In fact, I like it to be about an inch above grade or so, the top of the root ball. I want to dig a wide hole. These are general instructions for planting any shrub or tree. You want a wide hole, but not deeper than the root ball. You can mix in a lot of organic matter into the soil you dug up to make up a rich, fertile, soil. So you can add various types of compost. Do not use any steer manure in planting anything or anywhere in your garden. It's too salty. Steer manure is very high in salt. It's not going to be good for your soil, so don't use it. Use peat moss, use compost, bagged compost, use mulch from your own garden, but increasing the organic matter in the soil will be really good. If you want to save some money, get your roses as bare root in the winter. So the winter's coming up. You can get bare root roses at almost any garden center. If you go to a better nursery or a higher end, a little more expensive nursery and get roses with a bigger trunk, they will take off and do better than the little tiny ones you get at the big box stores. Those little tiny ones at the big box stores are a lower grade. They're smaller and they're slower to establish. At least that's my personal experience. But I like to get them bare root. I only have a few roses in my garden and I should take better care of them. Fertilizing. Repeat flowering roses perform best with repeated feedings throughout the growing season. Once flowering roses need less fertilizer. Feed them once as growth begins, a second time after blooming stops. So if you're getting into these old garden roses that only bloom in the spring, feed them at the beginning of the spring and feed them at when they finish blooming. But for the repeat bloomers, your hybrid teas, your floribundas, your grandifloras, you're going to want to fertilize them at least once a month throughout the entire growing season. So you can get a rose type fertilizer, follow the instructions on the bag, or you could use things like cottonseed meal, which is very popular all the time. I don't care that it's come from GMO cotton. You know, the organic standards, people don't consider it organic anymore because it comes from GMO cotton. I don't care. And so cottonseed meal is excellent source of nitrogen. You're very unlikely to burn your plants with it. Always water a plant prior to fertilizing and then water it after fertilizing. You do not fertilize dry plants, and you want to make sure they're well watered after you apply the fertilizer. Pruning. All roses will be more productive and attractive with some pruning. Thin out dead, weak, and old growth. Reduce plant size according to type of rose and demands of your climate. Well, if you're growing a climbing rose, you don't want to prune it all the way back down, you know, to a few feet from the ground. You want to let it grow up on the trellis or the wall or the fence. And so you're just going to maintain its shape and size and not do heavy pruning. But all the hybrid teas and a lot of the old garden roses, you prune them hard in the winter. Usually, you know, especially the modern roses, you prune them back to 3 or 4 canes, shin to knee height. And we'll have a little video on that too. Pest and disease control. It may be necessary to thwart various troublemakers, especially if you are growing modern roses. So the typical diseases you're going to get a powdery mildew, and you're going to might get rust, and you might get black spot. Although black spot is far less common in Southern California than in the wet, humid areas of the United States, like the Southern United States, Louisiana, Mississippi. In those areas, black spot is more of a problem because it is favored by, you know, high humidity and free water. And here, I didn't even see black spot until I started working at the Huntington. And then only on certain types of roses. In terms of diseases, you want to select plants that have good resistance to rust and powdery mildew. Otherwise, you're going to be spraying. And that's just going to reduce your enjoyment. It's going to be hard to keep up with a high level of, you know, spraying all the time. Spraying once a week, spraying every 2 weeks. And rust is particularly difficult to control. If you've got a rose that's highly susceptible to rust, it's going to be nearly impossible to control it without constantly spraying it with a broad spectrum of fungicide. So anyway, I just wanted to mention the extensive section on roses in the Sunset Western Garden book and some of the conditions that you're going to want to take care of your roses. Now, the tea rose, or the tea-scented Chinas, Rosa ex odorata, were oriental cultivars thought to represent hybrids of Rosa chinensis and Rosa gigantea, a large Asian climbing rose with pale yellow blossoms. Immediately upon their introduction in the early 19th century, breeders went to work with them, especially in France, crossing them first with China roses and then with Bourbons and Noisettes. The tea roses are repeat flowering roses, named for their fragrance being reminiscent of Chinese black tea. The color range includes pastel shades of white and pink and yellow to apricot, which at the time was quite a novelty to have yellow roses. The individual flowers of many cultivars are semi-pendant and nodding due to weak flower stalks. In a typical tea, pointed buds produce high-centered blossoms which unfurl in a spiral fashion like this. And the petals tend to roll back at the edges, producing a petal with a pointed tip. The teas are thus the originators of today's classic florist rose form. According to rose historian Brent Dickerson, the tea classification owes as much to marketing as to botany. A 19th century nurseryman would label their Asian-based cultivars as teas, as if they possessed the desirable tea flower form, and Chinas if they did not. Like the Chinas, the teas are not hardy in colder climates. Examples, let's take a look what I have here to show you. Let's take a look at, Parkinson's Pink China or Old Blush. That's our next flower. Let's take a look at that. This is a tea rose. And this one is called Parsons Pink China or Old Blush. Take a look at our next one, which is Cramisai Superior, which was mentioned in that video we just saw. And I want to make sure I get these various roses in the right groups. Then the next one is called Lady Hillington, which is a tea rose. And you can see this is looking very much like a modern rose. Our next one is also Lady Hillington. Let's take a look at that one. It's a close-up of the flower itself. This is a nice rose. And our next one is a bourbon rose. So let's talk about the bourbon roses. I'll tell you what, this is a bourbon rose. Bourbon roses originated on the Isle Bourbon, now called Reunion, off the coast of Madagascar in the Indian Ocean. They are believed to be the result of a cross between an autumn damask and the old blush China rose, both of which were frequently used as hedging materials on the island. They flower repeatedly on vigorous, frequently self-climbing shrubs with glossy foliage and purple-tinged canes. They were first introduced in France in 1823. Examples, this is Louis Odier, which is one of the examples. Let's see, the next one is a Souvenir de la Maison. Let's take a look at that one. That's it. This is a bourbon rose. And then our next group is the Noisettes, but it's time to take a break for station identification. I want to remind you that we're broadcasting from the campus at Cal State University, Dominguez Hills in Carson. Wonderful school, wonderful campus, great students, great instructors. Let's take a look at this brief station identification.
Watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Maybe you know how to use some of these platforms, but do you know how to make them work for your business interests? Most programs tell you to start with great content, but do they tell you how to create that great content? Creating effective content that can build a viral momentum is the hardest part of social media marketing. That's where we come in. The Certificate Program in Social Media Strategies and Content Marketing is a content-based course of study. During this 48-hour intensive immersion program, you will learn how to understand why some content goes viral while other content fails to gain traction. Identify your target audience, connect with them, and build them into a community. Create content that is specifically designed to inspire a positive emotional response and encourage engagement with your target audience. Distribute your content across the social platforms that are most appropriate for your specific goals. Become a thought leader in your area of expertise. This program is designed to help business owners, artists, and other creatives promote their professional ventures. If you're employed in public relations, advertising, marketing, journalism, publishing, education, or government affairs, this certificate can give you a professional edge toward promotions. If you're seeking employment in these areas, this certificate will let corporate recruiters know that you understand the importance of social media literacy. Enroll now.
My name is Zanea Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
It all comes back to this question, right? How do we define humanity?
One of the ultimate sets of values that the humanities program could bring to the future students is really lifelong learning tools that are just applicable in so many ways. I think what Hux 2.0 is doing is really going out of its way to celebrate through a theme, through the cohort theme, a multidisciplinary approach to some of these questions.
What is The advantage of having a graduate program in the humanities, I think as an undergraduate, you're still getting your bearings, right? You're learning the basics of the disciplines. But in graduate study, both of our anecdotes are about, being able to kind of do more with that once you have the foundations.
You can think of these courses not so much as just the core that everybody has to go through, but instead think of it, this is the basis for you to expand, for you to explore the things that you find interesting. But you will have a connection with the other students so that you can have some sort of starting point for those conversations to continue.
The benefits of this model involves the faculty because we can be closer to one another and we're going through the cohort theme with the students, so there's a nice continuity for us.
The thematic approach and building through a fairly tight structure of courses towards a culmination in the symposium allows us to really program not just our own individual classes, but think together about how we're programming a course of study.
All kinds of career choices that future HUC students will choose, I think there's a well-roundedness that the humanities disciplines bring to that ongoing process that never seems quite finalized because it can't be.
Well, I think we are excited about this, and I hope you caught a little bit of our excitement. We hope you can join us if this is the kind of program that you find interesting, and we look forward to working with you this fall and on through the five terms of this program.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Gardens of California, I'm your host and instructor. And I'm going to do something a little different today than I've done in previous classes. I'm going to go ahead and tell you our mystery plant because no one's called in to guess it. And I always forget to tell you at the end of the show because I get rushed. So these are cyclamens. And I bought these at a nursery when did I buy them? I forget now. It wasn't yesterday. It was a couple days ago. And so you can see how pretty they are. Let's go to an overhead and pick one that's actually looking pretty good. Take this white one. So cyclamens are a winter flower. They are grown from a tuber. Let's tip this over a little bit. And the petals actually are reflexed. They flip. There's the flower itself right in there. And here are the petals coming up. So see how that works like that. So they come in a whole bunch of different colors. They have nice foliage. I mean, you get a little bit of color in the foliage too. A lot of people grow these outdoors as a bedding plant. Come on back to me. So they can be used as a bedding plant, but they, in their natural native area, they're native to Europe and Southern Europe. There's a bunch of species of cyclamen. These are hybrids. And let's see what it says on the care tag, which I haven't read. And so let's see what it says. It says, it says large, abundant blooms over lush, marbled foliage on compact plants. Plant in full sun, 4 to 6 inches apart, grows 8 to 10 inches tall. And they don't tell you a lot more than that on the tag. Sometimes they'll give you watering instructions. They actually like to be kept a little wet. You don't want to let them go bone dry. They'll wilt. They'll wilt quite easily. On a day like today, where it's really quite warm, we're up close to 90 degrees in most of the inland valleys today, and we'll probably have a relative humidity less than 10%. It's hot and dry, typical fall weather. So they need to stay moist. So in this kind of weather, you're probably gonna have to water them like twice a week. But once we cool off, get into November and December, once a week, and as we get into late December, January, February, maybe every 2 weeks, especially if we get cold. But they will continue to bloom all through the winter, and then you're going to need to let them dry out. Now, in their natural habitat, they die back to the bulb, which is technically a tuber, and the foliage is gone for the whole summer. And then when it, you know, the rains come, then, or the winter starts to come, they grow new leaves and flower. So there's a lot of species. How many species of cyclamen are there actually in the wild? I'm looking here on Wikipedia. And 23 species of perennial flowering plants in the family Primulaceae, native to Europe and the Mediterranean basin, east to Iran, with one species in Somalia. They grow from tubers and are valued for their flowers with upswept petals and variable patterned leaves. So you can get them in a bunch of different colors, but you know, in these little 4-inch pots, they tend to wilt quite easily. So in a 4-inch pot like this, you're probably going to have to water them 2 times a week or even 3 times a week when it's hot and dry like today. They do like full sun, but they like it to be sunny but cool. So they're not a summer flower, they're a winter flower, but they're really pretty. And I'm just going to leave a couple of them right here because they're so pretty. And let's bring up on the screen right now our mailing address for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner Weights and Measures. If you want to send us a sample, here it is. Here's the two phone numbers. Plant Pathology is 562-622-0433. If you call that number and I'm sitting at my workstation, I'll answer the phone. You won't get a phone tree, which is a modern miracle today. And then the other number is 562-622-0431. That's going to be the entomology lab. And either Dr. Arkelian will answer or his lab assistant will answer the phone. Our mailing address. Can we bring up the mailing address? Here it is. If you have an insect and you want an ID, and before I even tell you this, it's free. We do not charge for any of our services in the two laboratories. So if you send us a sample, we look at it, we tell you what it is, and we try and help you out. At least that's my goal, is to help you control your pests, help you understand how to water, how to fertilize, how to prune, what does well where in your garden, what's good plant material for your garden as opposed to bad, something that's going to be difficult to grow that you're just going to be unhappy with because it doesn't do well. But anyway, for insects, send it to Insect ID, Los Angeles County Department of Agriculture at this address, 11012 Garfield Avenue, Southgate, California, 90280. Put your insects in a crush-proof container, put them in the freezer for about 15 minutes so they're dead, and then mail them in. You can come by if you want, but you probably want to give us a call because if you drive all the way down there, now I got to tell you, sometimes we're busy and we're not going to really have time to take your sample and look at it immediately and discuss it with you. So in terms of convenience and everything, it's probably more convenient to mail it in, and almost everyone mails in their samples. Again, it's free. You can send in diseased materials to me. Just send it to Jerry Turney, LA County Department of Agriculture, at 11012 Garfield Avenue, Southgate, California, or for Insect ID, LA County Department of Ag, at that same address. And please include a note with your name and address and phone number so that we can call you back. If you get your insects off a specific plant, please indicate which plant you got it off of. If you got it off of a geranium or an orange tree or a rose bush, please tell us where you collected the insect. If you send in, I get a lot of root samples because one of the major problems in gardens is root rot. And so, you know, Phytophthora root rot is a big problem. Armillaria root rot, the oak root rot fungus, that's a big problem. So if you send me just some roots, please also tell me in your note what plant it came from because I won't know just from looking at the roots. If you send in leaves and shoots, I also will probably, will help if you tell me the name of the plant. If you don't know the name of the plant, you can also email me photographs to my email address. And you can call me and I'll give that to you, or I can tell you what it is now. If you want to jot it down, it's my first name, the initial from my first name and my last name, J Turney. So JTURNEY at ACWM. Which stands for Agricultural Commissioner Weights and Measures, so ACWM dot LA County, spelled LACOUNTY, dot gov. So again, my email address is jturney at ACWM dot LA County dot gov. You can email me with questions about your garden. You can email photographs of plants in your garden, trees. If you don't know the name of your trees, you can take a picture of your tree, take a picture, an in-focus picture of your foliage, any fruit or flowers and the bark, and then a picture of the whole tree, And most likely I'll be able to tell you the name of your tree, and I can tell you if there's something wrong with it, I most likely can tell you what's wrong with it. I may need to talk to you about your tree, like how often you're watering it, you know, especially how often you're watering it, which I often ask. I say, how often are you watering the tree? And the answer is, oh, it gets plenty of water. That didn't answer my question. My question really is, how often are you watering it? Because the next question is, when you do water it, how long do you water it for? And we talked about this when we talked about water. If you stand out there with a hose and spray the soil underneath your orange tree for 2 or 3 minutes, you're only watering about a half an inch of soil. It's just going to evaporate and be gone, and you're not watering your tree. You want to deep water shrubs and trees for an hour or two, or some, depending on your application rate. If you're using a soaker hose, it may be for 6 hours or 10 hours. Depends on how much you turn on the hose and how quickly it soaks the soil profile. So, you know, it is key to understanding what's wrong with your plants if you've got a problem. How often are you watering and how long do you water for? So that's all very important stuff. And then there's a bunch of other questions I can ask. But let's go on to the roses, and we're going to now talk about the Noisette roses. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. Noisette or Noisette. The first Noisette rose was raised as a hybrid seedling in South Carolina by a rice planter named John Champanis. Its parents were the China rose Parsons Pink and the autumn flowering musk rose Rosa Muschata, resulting in vigorous climbing rose producing huge clusters of small pink flowers from spring to fall. Champanis sent seedlings of his rose to his gardening friend Philip Noisette, who in turn sent plants to his brother Louis in Paris, who then introduced blush Noisette in 1817. And this is the Prise à Valeurs Honnées, I believe. This is a Noisette rose you see here. The first Noisettes were small blossom, fairly winter-hardy climbers, but later infusions of tea rose genes created tea Noisette subclass with larger flowers, smaller clusters, and considerably reduced winter hardiness. Examples, blue blush Noisette, Lame Arcueil, Madame Alfred Caprice, and some of these are hard for me to pronounce. So now we'll move on to the next group, which are called hybrid perpetuals. And so the dominant class of roses in Victoria, England, hybrid perpetuals, re-blooming hybrids is what that really means, emerged in 1838 as the first roses which successfully combined Asian repeat blooming with the old European lineages. Since reblooming is a recessive trait, the first generation of crosses were stubbornly once blooming. But when these roses were recrossed with themselves or with Chinas or teas, some of their offspring flowered more than once. The hybrid perpetuals thus were something of a catch-all class derived to a great extent from the Bourbons, but with mixtures of Chinese teas, Damask Calicus, and to a lesser extent, Noisettes, Albas, and even Centifolias. They became the most popular garden and florist roses of Northern Europe at the time, as the tender tea roses would not thrive in cold climates. And the hybrid perpetuals' very large blossoms were well suited to the new phenomenon of competitive exhibitions. The perpetual in the name hints at repeat flowering, but many varieties of this class had poor reflowering habits. The tendency was for a massive spring bloom, followed by either scattered summer flowering, a smaller autumn burst, or sometimes nothing at all until next spring. Due to a limited color palette, white, pink, and red, and lack of revival repeat bloom, the hybrid perpetuals were ultimately overshadowed by their descendants, the hybrid teas. So let's take, here we see Ferdinand Picard. Actually, this is Lorraine. Let's take a look at the next one, which is another hybrid petite. This is Ferdinand and Richard. And let's take, now we'll talk about the hybrid musk. You can see there's so many different groups of roses. Although they arose too late to qualify technically as old garden roses, the hybrid musks are often informally classified with them. since their growth habits and care are much more like the old garden roses than modern roses. The hybrid musk group was mainly developed by Reverend Joseph Pemberton, a British rosarian in the first decades of the 20th century, based upon Algalea, an 1896 cross by Peter Lambert. The seedling of this rose, Trier, is considered to be the foundation of the class. The genetics of the class are somewhat obscure, as some of the parents are unknown. Rosa multiflora, however, is known to be one parent, and Rosa muscata, the musk rose, also figures in its heritage, although it is considered to be less important than the name would suggest. Hybrid musks are disease-resistant, repeat-flowering, and generally cluster-flowered, with strong characteristic musk scent. The stems tend to be lax and arching with limited thorns. Examples, Buff Beauty. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is a hybrid musk buff butterfly. Well, it's Buff Beauty, actually. I just have the wrong one written on my sheet. This is one of the hybrid musk roses. Next, we'll move on to the hybrid rugosas. The rugosas, likewise, are not officially old garden roses, but tend to be grouped with them, derived from Rosa rugosa from Japan and Korea. Beginning in the 1880s, these vigorous roses are extremely hardy with excellent disease resistance. Most are extremely fragrant, repeat bloomers, and moderately double flat flowers. Here you see Blank Double de Coubert from 1893. The defining characteristic of the hybrid rugosas is its wrinkly leaves, but some hybrids do lack this trait. These roses will often set hips. Examples, Hansa and Rosaire de Larry. Now come on back to me and we'll talk about some other roses before we move on to the modern roses. And this goes on and on, doesn't it? So Bermuda mystery roses, what are those? Well, this is a group of several dozen found roses growing in Bermuda for at least a century. The roses have significant value and interest for those growing roses in tropical and semi-tropical regions, since they are highly resistant to both nematode damage and fungal diseases that plague roses in hot, humid areas. They are also capable of thriving in hot, humid, so they are, you know, they do well in hot, humid climates. Most of these roses are thought to be of old garden rose cultivars that have otherwise dropped out of cultivation, or sports from those roses. They are mystery roses because their proper historical names have been lost. Tradition dictates that they are named after the owner of the garden where they were rediscovered. And I don't have any photos, and we're not going to talk, but you know, I said sports. So if you don't know what a sport or a chimera is when a branch on a plant has different leaves or flowers or fruit. A lot of times, it's not a good change, so it's a distortion, especially in something like citrus with an orange. If there's some characteristic about the orange that's different from the rest of the tree, well, if it's an improvement, that's great. Navel oranges are sports from a sweet orange in Brazil. And so a lot of roses are sports. Sometimes they're not stable. But what happens is you have a branch and you have all white roses and on that branch they're pink. That's a simple kind of a sport. And so you can cut that off, root it, and now you've got a plant that has pink roses. Well, lo and behold, you grow up that plant and most of the plant throws white roses. Then that's not a stable sport. Maybe it will be stable and you give it a name and you've got a new rose. And so a lot of new cultivars or cultivated varieties come as sports off of, you know, and some plants are really well known to sport. Roses sport a lot, camellias sport a lot, citrus will sport, or they're called chimeras. Miscellaneous roses. There are also a few smaller classes such as Scots, Sweetbriar, and some climbing roses of old roses, including Ayrshire, climbing China, Sempervirens, climbing tea, and climbing bourbon. Those classes with both climbing and shrub forms are often grouped together. So a climbing rose is not necessarily a class, it's a growth form. So you can have an old garden climbing rose, you can have a modern rose climbing rose. It's just its growth form. So let's talk about the modern garden roses. Classification of modern roses can be quite confusing because many modern roses have old garden roses in their ancestry, and their form varies so much. The classifications tend to be by growth and flowering characteristics. The flowering includes the most notable and popular classifications. The following includes the most notable and popular classifications of modern garden roses. The hybrid tea, let's bring up this picture, La France. This is the very first hybrid tea rose. And we'll tell you a little bit more about its history in a moment. As the favorite rose for much of the history of modern roses, hybrid teas were initially created by hybridizing hybrid perpetuals with tea roses in the late 19th century. La France, created in 1867, is universally acknowledged as the first indication of a new class of roses. Hybrid teas exhibit traits midway between both parents. Hardier than teas, but less hardier than the hybrid perpetuals, and more ever-blooming than the hybrid perpetuals, but less so than the teas. The flowers are well-formed with large, high-centered buds. Each flowering stem typically terminates in a single, shapely bloom. The shrubs tend to be stiffly upright and sparsely foliated, which today is often seen as a liability because it makes them more difficult to place in the garden or landscape. Hybrid teas became the single most popular garden rose of the 20th century. Today, their reputation as high-maintenance plants has led to a decline in their popularity. The hybrid tea remains the standard rose of the floral industry and is still favored in formal situations. Examples, and we're going to run through them. Here you have La France. Bring up our next one. This is Peace. And we'll just talk a little bit about the Peace Rose. The Peace Rose is Rosa Madame A. Milande. It was originally under that name. It's a well-known and successful garden rose. Over 100 million plants have been sold as of 1922, and that was a long time ago. It is a hybrid tea rose with large flowers of light yellow to cream color, slightly fused, flushed at the petal edges with crimson pink. It is hardy and vigorous and relatively resistant to disease, making it popular in gardens as well as in the floral trade. It was developed by French horticulturist Francis Milande in the years 1935 to 1939. When Milande foresaw the German invasion of France, he sent cuttings to his friends in Italy, Turkey, Germany, and the United States to protect the new rose. It is said that it was sent to the U.S. on the last plane available before the German invasion, where it was safely propagated during the war. But it later was named Peace to celebrate the peace after World War II. I see we have a call. Let's go to our next caller. Terry calling from Pasadena. You're on the air.
Yeah, I had a question. I belong to a community garden in South Pasadena, and we have a mulch bin. We have a bin, compost bin, and I wanted to know what we can put in it because we had somebody who was a master gardener come and talk to us, and she said we couldn't put any plants. Like, I have a squash plant with a powdery mildew. She said we couldn't put that in, or we couldn't put tomato plants with spider mites in it. What exactly can you put in a compost bin?
Okay. Well, let's start with what you should not put in. You should not put in any dog or animal droppings unless you want to add something like a chicken manure or guano just to accelerate your decomposition by adding nitrogen. But a lot of home gardeners will throw in dog droppings, and that's not recommended. In terms of plants themselves, pretty much any shoots you can put in your mulch pile. You mentioned powdery mildew and spider mites, or you know, the mites on tomato, which is the tomato russet mite, is a kind of spider mite. Mites are spiders in a way. They are arachnids, and arachnids have 8 legs, and that includes spiders, ticks, and mites, and they're not insects. But here's the thing. You don't want to put in anything in there that would be infected with a soil-borne disease or a soil-borne phase of the pest. So powdery mildew, if you've got squash with powdery mildew, no problem. Throw it in the mulch bin. Powdery mildew is a foliar disease. There's no soil phase. So all those spores that are on the leaves are going to die in the composting process. And certainly they'll die before next spring when you plant more squash. So it's, you're tearing out your squash, it's the end of the summer season, you throw it in the mulch pile. You can throw all the tomato shoots in there too. Now roots is another issue. If you suspect you had a soil-borne root disease, and in tomatoes it could have been fusarium or verticillium or phytophthora root rot or rhizoctonia. If you suspect you have a root disease, then throw the roots away in the trash. If you have, if you're sure you don't have any root diseases, if you have no root knot nematode, no nematode problems, and no fungal disease problems on your roots, you can throw the roots in too. Now, let's talk about weeds. If you're pulling weeds, you don't want to throw seeds in there. So if you're pulling young, just germinated seeds with no flowers or seed, throw them in. No problem. But if you're pulling up weeds that have all their seed heads and there's lots of seed, then either remove all the seed and throw in the leaves and shoots, but without the seed. One of the big problems with mulch is that you'll get a lot of weed seed in there. And then when you spread the mulch, all that will germinate and you get lots of weeds. So don't put in anything that's going to be covered with seed. Don't put in roots that you suspect are infected with a soil-borne pest. The shoots of most of your vegetable plants, no problem. Put them all in. Shoots are usually not a problem on your vegetable plants themselves. Particularly if you've got any of the sedges, like the yellow net sedge or purple net sedge, when you pull those up, you want to throw those in the trash. The nut sedges have on their roots little bulbets, little nuts. They call them nuts or bulbs, and each one of those is going to grow a new plant. And they often are not damaged during the composting process. And so you're going to spread nut sedge all over the place if you put the roots from nut sedge into your mulching bin. So the biggest thing to be afraid of is roots that are infested with a pest. And then seed. So avoid roots, avoid weeds that have gone to seed, but young weed plants that haven't seeded yet are fine to go in the mulch pile. All your shoots are pretty much fine to go in the mulch pile. Most of your shoots, your tomato plants, squash, corn stalks, all that stuff. They might even have a foliar disease, but those foliar diseases do not have a soil component in their biology, in their life cycle. And so the fungus itself, which is infecting the leaves, will not survive the composting process. And where do you get powdery mildew on your squash in the spring? Well, the spores are floating around in the air. They're not coming from the mulch. They're coming from either old squash plants that survived the winter, or they're coming, they're in the air. To tell you the truth, it's a good question where all that powdery mildew is coming from. I'd have to go in and see what an alternate host for the powdery mildew on squash is, because certainly anybody who grows squash gets powdery mildew. It's just so highly susceptible, whether you're growing, yellow crookneck, patty pan, what's the big green one, zucchini. All of those are highly susceptible to powdery mildew. But you can compost those, no problem. Okay?
Okay, well, thank you for all that information. I really enjoy your show. Thanks a lot.
Well, thank you for calling.
Okay, bye-bye.
So, in the old days, when I had a mulch pile, I used to throw in all the dog droppings. But then I was told that's a real bad idea not to do that. So I stopped. The dog droppings go in a plastic bag. I tie a knot in them, and they go in the trash. But all the shoots from my garden go in my mulch pile, all the shoots. If I'm pulling up weeds that have gone to seed, I tend to put those in the trash. If I'm pulling up weeds that haven't flowered yet, they go in the mulch pile. I'm not too worried about my roots. I don't think I've got any soil-borne diseases. So for the most part, I throw the roots and the shoots into the mulch pile. So, and as I said, the biggest problem with making your own compost is that you're likely either spread a soil-borne disease or you're going to spread weed seed. And that's a big problem too if you just go get free mulch from the city of Los Angeles. You're more likely to have a whole bunch of seedlings come up in that mulch because they don't have really good quality control. I still go get it. I use it. I don't mind. I'm going to put down cardboard and do sheet mulching to suppress my weeds anyway. So I'm not too worried about the seed coming in on mulch, but it can be a problem. So we talked about the peace rose. Let's go back to our picture on the peace rose. And here you have, let's see if we can get number 34 up, that peace rose, which was our first picture. Now these hybrid teas with a single flower at the top were really very, very popular and were the standard. Let's take a look at the next picture. Is also the peace rose. And this was peace because of the peace that came to Europe after World War II. Now let's take a look at our next one, which is called Double Delight. These are all hybrid teas. A hybrid tea rose bred by Swim and Ellis and introduced in 1977 grows to about, well, it's got a funny, you know, 90 to 150 centimeters, 75 inches, you know, it's about a 5-foot bush, blooms repeatedly and has strongly fragrant white flowers with dark red edges, flowers up to 30 petals. So this, I mentioned this one, Double Delight is particularly pretty. I tend to like these bicolors instead of just solid colors. This next one is called, this next one is actually called Garden Party. Let's take a look at a Garden Party. Is a hybrid tea created by Herbert Swim in 1959. Double-shaped flowers, creamy white with pink on the ends, and have 25 to 28 petals. Blooms repeatedly throughout the season. It is apparent to both Gold Medal and Double Delight. Our next one is Peer Gynt, tall hybrid tea with nice yellow 4.5-inch blooms and red edging. Repeat bloomer that will bring a ray of sunshine to your garden. Good for cutting and can be grown in a pot, petals 50. Our next one is Donna Darling, 1997, a new rose variety of the hybrid tea class characterized by a distinctive coloring of iridescent red fading to pale yellow on a vigorous, disease-resistant bush with lush green foliage. Our next one is Olympiad. Let's take a look at our next one, number 4, Olympiad. I see. That last one was Donna Darling again. This is Olympiad. Olympiad, exquisite blooms of pure red with all the qualities of great exhibition rose and prolific enough so that it can be depended upon for cutting all season long. The plants are tall, long-stemmed, and covered with fairly light green, heavily toothed foliage that is probably the most mildew-resistant in its class. Sam Greening has a strong belief that roses should be fragrant. Alas, this one has little fragrance. But it didn't stop it from being the best-selling red rose for most of the last 20 years. Flower size 4 to 6 inches, fragrance light, hybridizes McGreedy, 1984. Let's take a look at our next one, which is Chrysler Imperial. And I'll challenge anyone to tell me the difference between Chrysler Imperial and Mr. Lincoln. To me, they're virtually identical. Chrysler Imperial is strongly fragrant, dark, hybrid tea rose cultivar. This variety was bred and publicly debuted by Dr. Walter E. Lammerts of Descanso Gardens, La Cañada, California, in 1952. Its stock parents, Charlotte Armstrong and Mirandi, are both all-American rose selections. The elegantly tapered buds open in high-centered blossoms with a diameter of around 11 to 13 centimeters, which is about 5 inches, and can have up to 45 to 50 petals, which is a fairly high number for a hybrid tea. Rich, deep, velvety red color. Cultivar flushes in a chronological blooming pattern throughout its local season, starting in late spring until fall. The long-stemmed rose flowers are long-lasting and showy and make excellent cut flowers. Reaches 30 to 72 inches in height and a diameter of 24 to 48 inches for the shrub itself. The shrub is upright with very thorny canes and semi-glossy dark green foliage. It is not cold hardy and needs good sun exposure. Without good air circulation, it is susceptible to mildew and black spot, particularly in cool climates. So, let's see. Let's go on to Parentiana. So, let's take a look at our next one. This is Parentiana Salé d'Or. Oh, wait, I'm sorry. This is Chicago Peace. Hold on a minute. This is Chicago Peace, a color variant of the most famous rose of all time that was discovered in the Windy City of Chicago. The pink edge of Peace becomes deeper and sometimes suffuses the entire surface of the petals. And the reverse is a deep, rich gold. A rather unstable sport, and to keep your plants pure, cut the reversions to the point of origin. Same rugged plant and foliage, fragrant only if you have a good imagination. Weatherproof and hardy on a tough, disease-resistant plant clothed in glossy apple-green foliage. Hot weather is a favorite and it laughs at frigid temperatures. Flowers are 5 to 7 inches. Fragrance slight. Hybridizer Johnston, 1962. Now we'll go on to Perentiana. And this one is called Perentiana Salie d'Or. The French breeder Joseph Pernet Dusser initiated the first class of roses to include genes from the old Austrian briar rose, Rosa foetida, with his 1900 introduction of Soleil d'Or. This resulted in an entirely new color range for roses, shades of deep yellow, apricot, copper, orange, true scarlet, yellow biocolors, lavender, gray, and even brown were now possible. Originally considered a separate class, the Perentianas, or hybrid foetidas, were officially merged into the hybrid teas in 1930. The new color range did much to increase hybrid tea popularity in the 20th century, but these colors came at a price. Rose foetida also passed on a tendency toward disease susceptibility, scentless blooms, and intolerance of pruning to its descendants. So it's a gorgeous color, but you're going to have to put up with mildew and rust. So let's see. Let's talk about the polyanthus. Polyanthus literally meaning many flowered roses, from the Greek poly and anthos, flower, originally derived from crosses between two East. I think I've jumped ahead in my notes. Maybe not. So, polyanthus. So, polyanthus first appeared in France in the late 19th century alongside the hybrid teas. They featured short plants with tiny blooms, about 1 inch in diameter, carried in large sprays in the typical rose colors of white, pink, and red. The main claim to fame was their prolific bloom. From spring to fall, a healthy polyanthus shrub might be literally covered in flowers, creating a strong color impact in the landscape. Polyanthus roses are still regarded as low-maintenance, disease-resistant garden roses and remain popular for that reason. Good example, Cecil de Bruner. Let's see where that picture is. I probably don't have a picture of Cecil Bruner. And Harkness is another good variety. Oh, I see. I'm sorry. Let's bring that back up. This is polyanthus, Cecil Bruner. Our next one is polyanthus and Harkness. This is a Floribunda variety developed by Harkness and Company and introduced in 1979. It is basically an apricot rose, but with shadings of yellow at the base and in the center. It is notable for flowering very late in the year, producing clusters of 6 to 20 flowers up to 7 centimeters in size, with as many as 20 blossoms per single massive truss. This rose makes a whole vase full out of one stem, exceptionally long-lasting in water. The color of its 3-inch double blossoms is amber, shading to gold at the edges, a strong, narrow, upright bush with rich, deep green leaves, good repeat bloom qualities, and it has stood the test of time, makes a good cut flower. So those are the polyanthus. The floribundas. Some rose breeders saw potential in crossing polyanthus with hybrid teas to create roses that bloomed with the polyanthus profusion, but with hybrid tea floral beauty and color range. In 1907, the first polyanthus hybrid tea cross was made, introduced by Danish breeder Dines Poulsen. This had some characteristics of both parent classes and was termed a hybrid polyanthus or Poulsen rose. Further similar introductions followed from Poulsen, these often bearing the family name Els Poulsen. As their hybrid characteristics separated these new roses from polyanthus and hybrid teas, a new class was created named Floribunda, Latin for many flowering. Typical Floribundas create stiff shrubs, smaller and bushier than the average hybrid tea, but less dense and sprawling than the average polyanthus. The flowers are often smaller than hybrid teas, but carried in large sprays, giving a better floral effect in the garden. So you see, polyanthus are excellent in the landscape for color. Polyanthus are found in all hybrid tea colors and often with classic hybrid tea-shaped blooms, sometimes differing from hybrid teas only in their cluster flowering habit. Today, they are still used in large bedding schemes in public parks and similar spaces. So an example is this one here, Anne Harkness, and the other is Iceberg. And Iceberg is probably, let's take a look at Iceberg. Iceberg is probably one of the most common roses you're going to see. Let's take a look at our next picture. This is Iceberg. That's an individual bloom. Let's take a look at the whole shrub in bloom. So I see this all over. Iceberg is really common. Let's take a look at our next picture, 48. So it puts on a show like you wouldn't believe, although white isn't as showy as some of the other, you know, bright pinks and things like that. But it's really, really excellent. So Iceberg is a pure white rose from German breeder Rimmer Cords, who stole the show in 1958 and is one of the best known of all roses. There's also a rose burgundy iceberg. Let's take a look at that flower, which is next. Bred for hardiness and exceptional disease resistance, this Floribunda is prolific bloomer with lovely deep wine purple blossoms of compact variety that makes a perfect specimen in the smaller garden and a fine bedding plant for massing in large settings. Take a look at our next Floribunda, which is called Fire and Ice. This is a tall, bushy Floribunda with high-centered 4-inch blossoms of elegant red blend color. Repeat blooming throughout your growing season. Good foliage, bloom, and light fragrance too. Petal count 40, raised by Milan, France. This stunningly showy rose produces clusters of flowers of pure white centers and flaming red edges. Rather like the old favorite, Double Delight. Fire and Ice should be widely grown for its immense disease resistance. The foliage is lush, glossy dark green, and makes a wonderful foil for the magnificent procession of strong stems of blooms all over the shrub. The flowers are very durable in the vase, with one stem creating an impressive floral art decoration. Light fragrance. Now let's move on to the grandifloras. The grandifloras were the class of roses created in the mid-20th century to designate back crosses between hybrid teas and floribundas that fit in either category. Specifically, the Queen Elizabeth rose. And let's take a look at that. That's the next one up. Here's the Queen Elizabeth rose, which was introduced in 1954. Grandiflora shrubs are typically larger than either hybrid teas or floribundas, and feature hybrid tea-style flowers born in small clusters of 3 to 5, similar to a floribunda. Grandiflora has maintained some popularity from about the 1950s to the 1980s, but today they are much less popular than either hybrid teas or the floribundas. So we have here Queen Elizabeth. The next one is called Cherry Parfait. Queen Elizabeth, let's talk about Cherry Parfait. When it says, use the nearly continuous blooms of this yummy rose to pair with perennials or shrubs or display the outstanding colors in a striking mass planting. Flower size 4 inches, fragrance light. Rose is excellent in all climates. Truly outstanding 4.5-inch cup blooms. The color of creamy white with red edging and the dark foliage make this continuing blooming rose a wonderful addition to your garden. And again, I do like these bicolors more than some of the others. Let's move on and talk about some of the miniatures. Well, let's take a look at our next picture. It's the next picture of Cherry Parfait. Really striking rose, really pretty. Let's just talk a little bit about the miniatures and see if we have time to talk about diseases. Dwarf mutations of some old garden roses, Gallicas and Centifolias, were known in Europe in the 17th century, although these were once flowering just as their larger forms were. Miniature forms of repeat flowering China roses were also grown and bred in China and are depicted in 18th century Chinese art. Modern miniature roses largely derive from such miniature China roses, especially the cultivar Rouletti, a chance discovery found in a pot in Switzerland. So now I probably have just enough time to, I don't know, we're running out of time and I don't want to use up my time for just videos. Let's talk about climbing roses. Well, let's go through another couple pictures. Let's click through another picture. This Rex nose rose is Rosa. Let's see which one it is. That's here. You've got a climbing bourbon Zeppelin. Oh, let's see. Miniature rose climbing roses. Rosa Zeppelin Durhin. And this is it, climbing bourbon. Although the individual flowers are not particularly fine in themselves, they produce freely and have a wonderful fragrance. The semi-double blooms are a pure shade of bright rose pink, an almost thornless variety, prefers warmer climates. Controlling disease can be a problem. 12 feet is a vigorous shrub to 12 feet tall with thornless stems and highly fragrant double rose pink flowers. Now, the shrub roses. Well, you think of all roses as shrubs, but it's actually a group. This is not precisely defined class of garden rose, but it is a description of or grouping commonly used by rose reference books and catalogs. It encompasses some old single and repeat flowering cultivars, as well as modern roses that don't fit neatly into other categories. Many cultivars are placed in other categories are simultaneously placed in this one. Roses classified as shrubs tend to be robust and informal habit, making them recommended for use in mixed shrub border or hedging. So let's take a look at this next picture, which is Rose Molyneux, an excellent rose for bedding, although it is equally good for the border. It flowers with exceptional freedom and continuity, and has an even upright growth and little to no disease problems. The flowers are rich yellow. It has characteristic of tea rose fragrance with a musky background. Winner of a gold medal, the President's Trophy for Best New Rose of the Year at the Royal National Rose Society Trials. Now, there's another group of roses which are called English or David Austin roses. And David Austin started crossing modern roses with old roses to try and get that form. Let's take a look at our next picture. This is the Austin Rose Abraham Darby, 1985. And what he got was this old rose form with these, you know, curly petals all in here and this single row of flat petals on the outside, which is a, you know, a real old rose form, old garden rose form. But he got them in repeat blooming. So we'll just talk about these briefly. Although not officially recognized as a separate class of roses by any established rose authority, English or David Austin roses are often set aside as such by consumers and retailers alike. Development started in the 1960s by David Austin, who wanted to rekindle interest in old garden roses by hybridizing them with modern hybrid teas and floribundas. The idea was to create a new group of roses that featured blossoms with old-fashioned shapes and fragrances that would evoke the classic Gallica, Alba, and Damask roses, but with modern repeat blooming characteristics and the larger modern color range as well. Austin mostly succeeded in his mission. His tribe of English roses, now numbering hundreds of varieties, has been warmly embraced by the gardening public and are widely available to consumers. David Austin roses are still active, are still actively developed with new varieties released regularly. The typical winter hardiness and disease resistance of the classic old garden roses has largely been compromised in the process. Many English roses are susceptible to the same disease problems that plague modern hybrid teas and floribundas. And many are not hardy north of USDA Zone 5. So let's see if we got some of these. We'll take a look at this next one, which is Austin Tamora. Here's Austin Tamora, one of the earlier varieties and still a very worthwhile rose. It is closely related to the old Gloire de Dijon, and it is, has inherited both its lovely glistening apricot color and its delicious fragrance. It forms a short bush suitable either for rose bed or border. The flowers are first attractively rounded, opening up to a shallow cup. It has a remarkable and unusual fragrance with aspects of lilac and mimosa. So let's see what else we got here. Canadian Hardy. Well, no pictures of that, so come on back to me, and we'll talk about Canadian Hardy. a lot of the roses that were very popular were not hardy and were tender, and so they were hard to grow in very cold climates, and you had to go to a great extent to protect them during the winter. So they wanted hardier roses. So two main lines of roses were developed for extreme weather conditions of Canadian winters by Agriculture Canada at the Modern Research Station in Manitoba and the Experimental Farm at Ottawa. They are called the Explorer Series and the Parkland Series. These programs have now been discontinued. The remaining plant stock has been taken over by private breeders and marketed along with the Canadian Artist Roses as a single series. Derived mostly from crosses of Rosa rugosa or the native Canadian species Rosa arcansana, with other species, these plants are extremely tolerant of cold weather. Some down to minus 35 degrees centigrade, all have repeat bloom. A wide variety of forms and colors were achieved. So there's quite a few of those available, and these would do well in the, you know, where you have extremely cold winters. Montana, Canada, the Dakotas. And one of the things that, you know, everyone would do in those areas for their roses is they would prune them down low and then cover them with sawdust or mulch or something to protect them from the extreme cold of winter. That might not have been even enough if you're growing a tender variety. So these other Canadian varieties were developed. Landscape ground covers. There's been a move now. Let's take a look at number 59, ground cover Rosy Princess, to use roses, bring that up full screen, as a ground cover. And so these tend to arch over and then just come right back down. They don't grow as upright shrubs, they grow prostrate. Developed mainly for mass planting. In the late 20th century, traditional hybrid tea and floor bunner rose varieties fell out of favor with gardeners because they didn't want to go to all the trouble of controlling the diseases. Landscape roses, also known as ground cover roses, have thus been developed to fill the consumer desire for a garden rose that offers color, form, and fragrance, but is also low maintenance and easy to care for. Most have the following characteristics: lower growing habit, usually under 24 inches, repeat flowering, disease and pest resistant, growing on their own roots, minimal pruning. So this is just an example of one of them here. And take a look at our next picture, which shows a broader look at it. Now let's talk briefly about diseases, because let's just take a look at our last picture, because we're running out of time. And our last picture is powdery mildew. And really the answer is to select varieties with good resistance. But you can control this with milk and water at about anywhere from 10% to 50% milk and water and spraying once a week. But I see we've really run out of time. We're not going to get to look at all the different pictures of the diseases and pests. Let's take a look at what we're going to talk about next week. So you guys can jot this down or know if you want to come. We talked about oaks and citrus and roses, and next week we're going to talk about cactus. So we're going to talk about the cactus family and the fact that cactus are native to the Americas. They are New World plants. But we're down to our last 30 seconds. I want to thank the crew for coming in on Sunday and helping put on the show, and thank everyone who called in today. So it's hot out. Good time to plant your winter seed. Keep it moist for a week or two so it comes up. Until then, I'll see you next week, and happy gardening. Get out and enjoy our warm weather. Take care.